Now, everything old is new again. America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
It's a privilege to do this job, to introduce the world to new music, to shape the culture.
Richie, we're going to be bankrupt in a month.
Going in a new direction, trying to bring us into the future.
Well, you're over there in the future. I'm here in the present, trying to keep the lights on.
Nick, we're about to turn a corner.
Exactly what the Nazis told my Uncle Isaac. Showers, right around the corner.
Welcome to Everything Old is New Again. This is Douglas Viviani together with the ever excited David Cohen.
I am excited today.
And why are you excited this week?
We have a really great guest here today. He's a favorite actor of mine from when he originally appeared in a show I watched growing up, and my wife and I have kind of followed his career and love it whenever he's on. It's Max Cassella, who is appearing in the drama series on HBO Vinyl, playing the role of Julius or Julie Silver. Max has also appeared in other big screen movies like Blue Jasmine, Inside Llewyn Davis, Killing Them Softly. The list goes on and on. And he's currently starring in a dark comedy film, Applesauce, which premiered at the 2015 Tribeca Film Festival. So we also know him from The Sopranos and Boardwalk Empire. And we're going to get into all that stuff with Max. So welcome to the show, Max.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for having me.
It's our pleasure. Truly our pleasure. We're going to dive into a number of different topics, but since right now we're just mentioned Vinyl and started off with Vinyl, let's dig into that, which is a tremendous series on HBO that is produced and written and created by Terry Winter, a old law school buddy of mine. We had him on the show a number of weeks back and had some fun with him. Of course, Martin Scorsese is involved in that and co-creating and directing, and none other than the Rolling Stones lead singer, what's his name again?
Mick Jagger.
Yeah. So we've got some good pedigree there. I'm just wondering, the news just came out after the first episode that HBO is renewing this show for a second season. I don't know, was there any scuttlebutt about that? Where do you stand on that?
I don't know. I mean, do you think it was too soon? For me, it couldn't have been too soon.
I think it's great. Listen, I think it's tremendous. I'm just wondering, like, did HBO see, like, some advance? I'm sure they saw other episodes and were hopped up.
Here's what I think. You know, we still need to find our audience. And the way people are watching TV these days, as you know, it's very difficult to judge who's watching what and when. You know, with everybody DVRing or, you know, watching it on demand, what have you. So we still need to find our audience, even though we come in with a lot of attention due to the people and the names involved. But I think HBO needs to give us at least 2 years to do that. I mean, their investment is this is not a cheap show to make. It's, as you can see on the screen, it looks so beautiful, and it's expensive.
Yeah.
So you know, we got 10 episodes for this season, and we're going to do, I'm assuming, 10 for the next season. And then I'm sure HBO will take stock of where we're at that point.
Now, I agree with you. Oh, I'm
20
sorry.
20 episodes, guys, it's not a lot to ask for a show to, like, find its feet. You know, usually in a network show, that's less than one season right there.
Exactly. And just to remind the audience a little bit that this is co-created by a gentleman that created the Boardwalk Empire and was involved with The Sopranos. So those series, especially Boardwalk, Sopranos too, so character driven. You got to roll your sleeves up as a listener or watcher of the show and get invested in who these people are, figure out their motivations. They're very deep and colorful characters and you can't do it in 1 hour or 2 hours. So I agree with you. I think that's terrific. Maybe you could just give us a smidge of generally the idea of what the show is and your character in particular.
Well, my character is Julie Silver. I'm the head of the A&R department at American Century Records that Bobby Cannavale is the founding president of. And my job is, you know, in A&R, A&R stands for Artist and Repertory, is to discover new artists. And hone them and to develop them and then break them to the public, basically. And that's what my job is. And I think that at the beginning of the show, what we realized is that the character of Julie, he may be a walking encyclopedia of American and music. He's absolutely clueless at this point where music is going to go next. In 1973, everything is in flux, you know. Music is about to explode in like two or three different directions, punk rock and disco being the most obvious. And Julie is just, you know, he's a guy in his 40s and he doesn't know what's hip anymore, doesn't know what's around the corner anymore.
Like, I think you can see
where he's at.
Yes, you can see that in one of the scenes. I think it was the second episode where Julie's out in the field and he's listening to basically a garage band, and he hears them, and it's kind of it's punkish, of course, a punk rock. It's totally different than he's used to, and he basically tells them, "I listen, do two songs of your own, but do me a favor, play the Kinks, learn the Kinks song. I forget which song was recommended, and tape that, and we'll listen to that." I guess that's
Julie's frame of reference, you know, basically telling them to sound like something from 15 years previous. Not 15 years, whatever it was, 64. It's like 9 years previous or whatever it was. You know, he doesn't get it. He doesn't get it. This is new music. To him, it sounds like garbage.
Right.
He's not the only one. I mean, the whole company is sort of filled with these people that are stuck in the past, the 60s and the flower, you know, child movement and that whole thing. That's like it's dead. You know?
Right. It's a great concept for the show to start with. I thought it was a really great period piece. Now, Max, you've worked with Bobby Cannavale before. You worked with him in that great movie, the Woody Allen movie, Blue Jasmine.
Yeah.
How is it? Tell me a little bit about, you know, your relationship with Bobby and how it's progressed.
Bobby, I've known for years. Actually, we have many friends in common. I've known Bobby for a long time. We got to work a bunch of times on the stage. You know, we've been members of the same theater company in New York, the Labyrinth Theater Company.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
And finally, on Blue Jasmine, we became buddies because we were there for a while. And that was, it was great. I mean, we have really, really great chemistry. You know, Bobby's from the theater. He knows how to work with actors. It's just we have a real nice camaraderie and chemistry between the two of us, and for that matter, most of the entire cast is made up of, you know, theater people, and you know, the entire cast is fantastic, and everybody gets along great.
Great. And can you roll your sleeves up a little bit when you're performing in that particular scene we were talking about with the Kinks, and there's in other scenes where you have the opportunity, it looks like a little gleam in your eye, you're able to do a little bit of a comedic kind of a touch or a lighthearted or different touch that'll put a smile on someone's face and some would say in such a dark or a, you know, project. It's not really dark, but serious project. Where does that come from? Is it a directed point of view? Is it something that you're bringing to the table as an interpretation, or how do we work that?
I think it's in the writing. Right. It's a funny scene, you know, and I'm a funny actor, and it just comes out naturally. I mean, whether or not they write, I mean, look, Terry has mentioned to me on numerous occasions that he, when he was writing his character, he heard my voice while he was writing the Julie's character. So he already knows me from all the other things, you know, Boardwalk Empire, Sopranos, and the years I've known Terry. So when he's writing it, he's kind of hearing it and hearing my voice. And, you know, I have a very strong comedic background. So
terrific. We'll be right back. Right back.
Yeah,
everything
sure.
Old is new again. Terrific. We have 2 minutes here now for the remaining of the portion of this section. I didn't mean to cut you off there, but it was
no problem.
It's perfect. You do have that, and I think a show like this, in some ways, it needs a light section here and there.
You gotta have it. You got any show?
Yeah,
any show. It's gotta have both. You know, you can't just be relentlessly dark.
And it's funny, you've got Ray.
Need levity.
Exactly. You've got Ray Romano there as, of course, a comedian. And I don't have seen yet anything really comedic from him, which is so interesting. I wonder if as this series develops, and you've been on a series before, especially working with Terry, does your input and the way you're presenting a character, does that give them a little room to say, hey, you know what? This is something that this gentleman does so great. Let's run with this. Or are they, you think, they've already got in mind pretty set in stone?
I mean, besides what they've started with, I think on any TV series, they're going to right for the actors, that they know that the actors that are on the series every week, writers, they're stuck, they write for you, you know, they know who they're writing for, and they see things developing between the characters, and they go, gee, these two guys are great together. Let's keep writing for this, you know, these guys, you know what I'm saying? Let's keep writing. That relationship really works. Let's do more with that. And as far as Ray Romano's concerned, I don't know what I'm remembering, whether it's from something that's already aired or down the road, but I find that what he does is very, 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 very funny. You know, not sitcom funny, but in just...
He can't help it. He can't help it be funny.
His line delivery, you know, he's a comedian.
Right,
that,
right.
That comes forward. The fact remains is the reality is this world is at turns dark and hysterically funny, perverse, and not to have comedy wouldn't be even accurate.
We'll be back on Everything Old Is New Again.
You're listening to Everything Old Is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
Our future, everything, it's all riding on this company.
You got a guilty conscience, and this is what you come up with? That's it. That's all I got.
I promise I'm going to bring us back.
Let's show people how rock and roll is supposed to make you feel.
Heaven knows they want to.
Welcome back to Everything Old Is New Again. This is Douglas Viviani with David Cohen, and we are happy to have with us Max Cassella, who's playing the role of Julie or Julius Silver in Vinyl, which is on HBO every Sunday night at 9 o'clock. Tune it in. It's a tremendous show. Going to deviate just a smidge here because Mr. Cassella has quite a background in Broadway as well. If you didn't know, he was the original Timon on Broadway, 1997. In The Lion King, correct?
That's correct.
And it's
correct, sir.
And then you again would then be on the. I didn't think about this, but my little girl listens to the CD of the Broadway show. I guess that's you're on that. I presume, right?
Yeah, I'm on that. My kids listen to it as well.
So you've got some little smidge of singing background there, because I know you were also in the Music Man in 2000.
I was in
right?
The Music Man revival on Broadway 16 years ago. I was in a movie of Newsies.
Right.
That I sang and danced in. I've done a lot of singing and dancing in my day.
And where does that fit in with the career? Do you think you want to get involved if you have the opportunity to do that again at some point? Or
Nah, you know, I would love to. I have nothing against musicals. There's some that I like. A lot of them I don't like. I swore off doing them, particularly 8 shows a week on Broadway.
That's
with
tough.
Music Man, it was the final straw. It was not, you know, I realized this is not for me. And but I would certainly love to do a movie musical again at some point. I would love that. But doing 8 shows a week on Broadway, singing and dancing, there's no way. There's no way. I mean, I love doing plays. And if I were to do a play on Broadway, that'd be great. But I would only want to hopefully do it for like a couple of months.
There you go. I know you've done, in 2011, you did Relatively Speaking, which is directed by John Turturro, 3 one-act comedies, right? One written by Woody Allen you were in,
comedies.
Right?
I was in 2 of them, one by Woody Allen and one by Ethan Coen, half of the Coen brothers.
Now, here's the thing. With all of those broad, you know, you've got The Lion King, which was a project that was created from the movie project and then it adapted for Broadway. Music Man, I believe, was from the 47, I think it was created just for Broadway, of course. And then I think, of course, Relatively Speaking, I think it was written for, that if it wasn't for Broadway, it certainly was for the stage as an original work. So we've done some shows in the past about Broadway, and I just want to throw something to you as somewhat more of an expert for sure than us, and someone has got some great experience with Broadway. Where do you stand on projects that are created just for Broadway versus something like The Lion King, which is terrific, but was a project in another venue, like in the movies, before Broadway? Is there, do you, as an actor, do you see a difference in the, at least the creation of these works, and or do you like them or not?
It's difficult to say.
Yeah.
I think, you know, with The Lion King, it's such a beautiful show, and it's what Julie Taymor did with that was elevate what that movie was. I mean, you could almost like forget about the movie. What she did with that was elevate it to like fantastic art. The movie was highly successful, but it wasn't that special. far as I'm concerned, she took it to another level. I think that oftentimes there's like a rat, it's like an epidemic on Broadway. I don't know, because I don't really go that much, but I mean, there's a lot of movies turned into musicals, seems like, but I haven't seen too many that to have much of an opinion on it. Although, you know, you kind of just instinctively go, wouldn't it be nice if they, you know, came up with some original stuff? Like, do we need the School of Rock on Broadway? I don't know.
Exactly. Meanwhile, Andrew Lloyd Webber, who is tremendously celebrated, of course, a genius of our time on Broadway, he takes that project and adds his skills to that. So it's a curious thing. I guess it's about what you can market in for the guy in, I don't know, in South Dakota or Iowa that visits New York. They're going to recognize, I guess, a particular name of a project that they've heard in the movies. And so maybe they're figuring they can go and jump on that.
People like, you know, especially people maybe not theater sophisticates, like this, recognize a property already. Like, oh, I love that movie. Let's go see it on Broadway.
Right.
Tickets are so expensive. You know, you can't afford to, like, you know, if you're coming into the city to see a show, you don't want to, you know, blow $100 or more. If you have kids, you know, then bring the whole family. You're spending hundreds of dollars to see a show. Like, well, you don't know anything about it. I think, you know, it'd be great. A pipe dream, but I think it'd be great. If ticket prices were to come down, there'd be more original things on Broadway, you know.
Yeah.
Ticket prices were cheaper, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
I don't know.
I'm going to turn the tide a little bit here and go towards the sports and venue, because you did act in a project back in 2007, but that's just a hint. I'm going to play a short clip and see if you recognize or anybody recognize who this is.
We'll still have Jackson, we still got Guidry, and we still got Gossage, and we still got Bucky Dent, Willie Randolph, and guys that were here on the championship clubs, Greg Nettles. So every club makes some changes, but this isn't a vastly revised ball club. Basically, this club is intact from the 78 club.
Okay. Max Cassell, any idea who that was?
I have no idea.
I think you played the gentleman, Dick Howser?
Is that Dick Howser?
You believe it or not? That's, I know, it's impossible.
Yeah, I was going to say, I knew it was like somebody from the Yankees.
Yeah, that wasn't fair at all, but Dick Howser.
Dick Howser, I would never know what the real Dick Howser sounded like.
There you go. Now,
I would never recognize that in a million years.
Honestly, if it was Billy Martin or somebody, you know, I'm not going to say charismatic, but somebody, you know, that you recognize.
Billy Martin, I would have recognized his voice. George Steinbrenner, I probably would have recognized his voice.
But you made him come alive in The Bronx Is Burning with John Turturro in 2007.
You're way too kind.
Well, he was alive.
Well, you just heard the real Dick Howser. Anything could have made him come alive. So, how was the transition from Doogie Howser to Dick Howser? Was there a certain career path you were following, Max?
None whatsoever. None whatsoever.
My point
those
of view is
like
that
dark days. Those were like barren days, man.
But you grew up in Cambridge. I know that you love New York, and you've talked about that, you know, your heart, you feel like a New Yorker, I believe. But you went to high school with, I got to be a lot of Sox fans, and possibly were a Sox fan yourself, I don't know, in high school.
I used to be when I was a little kid. I used to love, like, because when the Red Sox, when I was a little kid, were like the 75, 76 Red Sox when they were in the series. I remember being a little boy and being, like, seriously into the Red Sox.
Bucky Dent made quite an impression back then, right?
Yeah, sure they did. I could name like so many people from the 75, 76 team, like Freddie Lynn, Jim Rice, Bob Montgomery, Bernie Carbo, Rico Petrocelli. I mean, I still remember them all.
Right.
And now you're thrown into a project to represent the what do they call that? The evil empire.
Right.
I'm sure it didn't have anything to do with it, but what was your psyche going into that particular role?
Which one are you talking about?
Dick Howser.
Why was that a dark period, as you mentioned before?
No, it wasn't. It was dark, not so dark. It was just like, it was hard for me to work.
Right.
You know, I didn't get, it was like, there was not a lot, not like now. I'm doing much better now. I'm doing so many exciting things now. But back then, I was like, Dick Howser, it was okay. It wasn't, you know, like a great part or anything.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
I didn't think I was particularly, you know, terrific in it either.
So you didn't answer to your buddies, you know, that were Sox fans, what are you doing playing a Yankee or anything like that, right?
First of all, I haven't been in Boston. I left Boston after high school, actually Cambridge, and I have no family there. I've not been back there except maybe once to work in, like, whatever, 30 years or something like that. My parents are from the Bronx. I'm a New Yorker.
Right.
So
good
I
to
don't
hear.
Even know any? I don't know any of the people that I knew from Cambridge. Really, I'm not in contact with any of them. I mean, maybe one kid that I grew up with here and there, but nothing like that. I don't have any ties there, emotionally or any or family wise. Nothing.
And speaking of the future projects, or you've got, we're going to turn to that in our next section. There's some exciting projects you have that I want to ask you about. Before we do, we're going to take a short little break here, and we'll
sure.
come on back on Everything Old Is New Again. But before we do, I want to just thank you so much for your time again. And we are
Absolutely.
With Max Cassella, who is a boss of A&R, the head of A&R, on the HBO series Vinyl, Sundays at 9 o'clock. We'll be right back, and Everything Old Is New Again.
Hey, Charlie, why the arm in the sling?
Yeah, I walked straight into that busted street sign in front of Frank's Automat.
Well, you must have been really sore at him.
You said it, pal. I said, say, what's a big idea making a fella trip out there? I was going to sock him right in a kisser.
He's all wet. Why, you ought to sue him, Charlie.
I have half a mind to do just that. But where am I going to get that kind of dough?
Say, I know a fella just got me out of a big jam, and he didn't break the bank.
You don't say.
Yeah, the law office of Douglas Viviani.
The law office of Douglas Viviani?
That's right, the law office of Douglas Viviani.
Viviani.
That's what I said, Viviani.
He a straight shooter?
He's a cat's meow.
He's on the up and up?
Doug's ace is with me.
Is that so?
He's a bee's knees.
Well, that's just swell. You have his number?
You can call him at 631-681-1910 or email him at ViviniLaw.com.
Wait, what was that last part?
What, email?
Yeah, what's email?
ViviniLaw.com.
Now, back to America's entertainment pop culture talk show, Everything Old Is New Again, with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
When I heard your song, it stopped me in my tracks. It was raw, hard. It connected me to your world. Crime, drugs, sex, guns, madness. Do you have any idea how huge that is?
Welcome back to Everything Old Is New Again. This is Douglas Viviani with the ever-excited David Cohen, who is excited because we are with Max Cassella, who is performing in the HBO series on Sunday nights at 9 o'clock Vinyl, which has now been approved for a second season, which we are excited about because this is a tremendous series brought to you by Martin Scorsese, Mick Jagger, and Terence Winter. It's tremendous. If you watch that series, you can definitely see and acknowledge, let's say he stands out, Max does, in his look. Max, you've got that 1970s look down with the clothes.
Yeah, and nice fro going there.
Where did that come from? Is that something you did, or would that come from a combination of things, or what?
When I got the job, like they said, don't cut your hair, don't shave your face. Marty, meaning Scorsese, you don't want to, you know, mold your look. So the hair makeup people, you know, I just grew everything out. So I had this big bushy beard and a big, you know, Jew fro on. And Marty just said, I love that the way it is. Leave it, you know.
And has anybody, I mean, I don't know, it's just, has anybody mentioned, I mean, it's just so distinctive when you're on the screen. It really, I don't know, if maybe it's because I lived through it, places you back in the 70s with that and what you're wearing with these plaid, silky shirts with the, not plaid, but the, you know, those, like, what do you call them, the prints on them and so forth. Anyway, I just think it's great. It really is a great period piece, and we'll get back to a little more discussion of Vinyl shortly. But first, I want to dig into a little bit of the future projects or present that will be released future projects of Max Cassella. And the first one is Jackie, the bio picture, I believe, of Jackie Kennedy Onassis, starring
That's
Natalie
right.
Portman.
That's right.
And I think you're playing a gentleman that people would recognize if they saw this picture of Jack Valenti, if you lived through, he's passed away since 2007, but lived through a little ways back. He was pretty well known in his time, but one thing I know that he was in the presidential motorcade when Kennedy was assassinated, and this
right,
is the
he's
character.
In that famous photograph on Air Force One when LBJ is being sworn in with Mrs. Kennedy. His face is right there. He was, as you know, later on, I knew him as the head of the Motion Picture Association
right.
for many years. But back then, he was Lyndon Johnson's top aide.
Right.
So that's the this picture Jackie takes place between the assassination, like the 4 days between that and the funeral. And Natalie Portman is playing Jackie Kennedy. And it's really a movie about like the inside of her head, what's going on psychologically.
Wow. Yeah. So it's just spending those 4 days. And of course, that would be something you could really roll your sleeves up and dig into, because what didn't go on. If you didn't live through it, if you see on YouTube and all that, what went on with the coverage and so forth, that's just from the outside looking in. Do you know who, you know, got involved with getting the facts of what went on during those 4 years to write this screenplay?
I believe it was based on a few different books, but I'm not sure which is the most prevalent.
And Jack Valenti had a relationship with Jackie Kennedy throughout that time period, I guess.
Here's what happened. Yeah. So Jack Valenti, at the time, he's from Houston, and he owned a prominent advertising firm. So LBJ had a head of the Texas visit in '63. He called Jack Valenti and said, I want you to make our Houston stop, a Houston leg of the trip, a huge success, which Valenti made sure that it was, made sure the streets were lined, throngs of people. And he did so well in Houston that when the president and LBJ went on next to Dallas, that Fort Worth and then Dallas, that he asked Valenti to come along with them. Valenti and LBJ going back quite a ways because they're both from Texas. Then the assassination happens. Valenti's in the motorcade. He's like eight cars back. Everybody ends up at the hospital. The word comes down. The president's been shot. He's dead. LBJ is on Air Force One. He calls Valenti to his side on Air Force One. He asks him right there, I want you on my staff. Valenti thought he was leaving Houston for a few days, and he had packed an overnight valise. And next thing you know, he's on a flight to Washington to start a new life. He never went back again. He had his wife, he had his family brought over, and he was LBJ's top man. So there was a huge, during these 4 days, there was a huge sort of bitter, poisonous relationship between the Kennedys and what was known as in the White House as the Texas Mafia, all the usurpers, as she saw, the coming in.
Right.
So that's really where what my role in the film is right. Illustrates.
So we can look for that. That'll be in, I think, 2017 released, right?
That's right.
And that's Jackie with Natalie Portman and of course, Max Cassella. And another one that is going to be released on New Year's Eve of this year, I guess we'd say New Year's Eve 2017. Live by Night. Directed, produced, written, starring Ben Affleck, a 1920 story of a son of a Boston police captain becomes a gangster. So you're involved in that project as well. Just give us a smidge about what we can expect with that.
Based on a Dennis Lehane novel by the same name. Really great, great book. And what I play is I play the son of a guy named... He's the head of the this family in Boston, Italian gangster family that they're bringing in illegal liquor. He hired Ben Affleck to run our operations in Florida. So, but I'm a complete dunce and an idiot, and my father's the boss, so everybody has to answer to me. And it's actually quite funny.
All right. So, is that supposed to be a comedy or a dark comedy, or what's
not
that?
At all? Not at all. Right. Not at all. Okay. But it's, all right.
I have a question for you, Max. As a fan of yours, my wife and I, like we said, we grew up with loving the character you play with Doogie Howser, and we're not going to go into that, but we remembered you from that. So everything you've been in, at least in movies or TV, we're like, oh, there he is. That's great. And we think you're a fantastic actor.
So, thank you.
You're welcome. And as a fan, so I've got to ask this question, because one of the memorable scenes I remember that you were in, and it was Boardwalk Empire, which I loved, and you played Leo D'Alessio.
Yeah.
great role. But one of the memorable scenes where my wife and and I were watching it and we're like, no, don't do it, was when you were, your character was sitting in the barber chair, you had the shaving cream on you,
right,
and
right.
You had your, basically, you know, your throat was slit through the shaving cream. And it was just such a memorable scene for us. What, tell me a little bit what that was like when you were doing it.
Well, I was really upset because I got, my character was killed off.
I'm sure.
I didn't love doing it, but it was basically shot in my neighborhood at the local barbershop.
Huh.
Where I started, I was getting my hair cut all the time, and I was, after that, I discovered this place. I was like, wow, this place is great, and I would get my hair cut there. And the blood stain is still on the floor, on the wood stain floor from my shooting that scene.
Oh, wow.
And it was just, you know, shooting the actual scene was, they just rig you up with this thing that oozes blood. They put the bar, you know, the shaving cream all over it, and then it comes in, and you know, you just do it. It was simple, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, sorry to see that for you and for us, but yeah.
Yeah, no, I was you know, I was bummed out to be doing it.
But you're back, and we're back on Everything Old Is New again right after this.
Yeah.
Playing a bit of Rolling Stones here. You have any feeling or any interaction with Mick Jagger, for, you know, from Vinyl, like his input in this project? Do you hear about it or no?
I hear that his input is, you know, very prevalent. My own interaction with him is, you know, not that much. And when he's there, I say hello to him. You never know what to say to a rock and roll legend like that. I mean, what do you say to this guy? You know, it's like, he's been around. Scorsese's been around. They're like very involved.
Right. Yeah. And he's just, I mean, I would suggest that, what do I know, but he's been through and seen or at least heard about all of what's going on.
I imagine that they lean on him quite a lot for reference and authentic, you know, is this authentic, you know, I'm sure they ask him all the time, you know, for ideas from his life, you know, because this man is rock and roll, you know?
Right, exactly. Basically, in some ways, telling his story. I think it's interesting how they've got, you know, every so often you'll see an act like Led Zeppelin in Vinyl, and I don't know if they're actually mentioned by name. Oh, they were, and the actors do a great job with presenting these personalities. You don't know these characters behind the scenes, but Mick Jagger is interesting. Must be such an artist to be able to convert his talents to the big the little screen, I guess they call it, right, to television. And this tremendous project.
Plus, he got his son a job, so, you know, it's not
bad. Exactly. Exactly. James is great. Jimmy Jagger is fantastic.
Yeah. And he plays, the David Johansen character, correct? Is that the one?
No, he plays the lead singer of the Nasty Bits, the punk rock band that I'm trying to turn into the Kinks.
There you go. That's it. We'll be right back with Max Casella on Everything Old Is New Again to talk a little more about Vinyl on Everything Old Is New Again.
This is Everything Old Is New Again, America's entertainment pop culture talk show with Douglas Viviani and David Cohen.
This is Terence Winter, writer and executive producer of The Sopranos, creator and executive producer of Boardwalk Empire and the new Vinyl on HBO. And you're listening to my friends Douglas Viviani and David Cohen on Everything Old Is New Again.
Ah, what a great introduction. How timely. I don't know how that came into play so perfectly. I don't know who set that up, but that was perfect. Because we are here talking about Vinyl, and we've been talking about the career and having some fun with Max Casella, who is in Vinyl. And that's Terrence Winter. I went to law school with Terry, and so we go a ways back. And that kind of leads me into this next little bit that I wanted to discuss. So I know that in high school you went to school with Matt Damon, and at the same, I should say, the same high school as Ben Affleck. Dave and I went to high school together quite some time ago.
Oh, wow.
We're not gonna.
Yeah, we're often compared with Damon and Affleck. People confuse us all the time.
See how you put them in the same sentence? At least that worked out nicely. And again, I went to law school with Terry. And so the question is, developing relationships early in life, and you know, when you connect with some people, just as a general idea, I feel that gives life a nice color. If you can continue to keep in touch, which is not always easy, I presume that you feel the same way, or how do you feel about your development of your relationships early in life to now?
To be totally honest, I'm not really in touch with anybody from the Cambridge days. I recently had the immense pleasure of, like, reuniting with my best friend from when I was 10 years old, this guy David McManus. And, you know, through the internet, you know, you're able to find people.
Right.
But generally, my oldest friend is the first person, my first friendship I made when I moved to New York outside after high school. And he's still my friend 30 years later.
That's it.
But I'm ashamed to say maybe that I've lost a lot of touch with the people from the first 18 years of my life.
Well, it's very easy to do. My grandfather had said to me a long time ago, I was trying to make friends with everybody. He's like, listen, you make a couple of good friends in life, and that lasts through your life. You've been successful, really. Talking about that, maybe they're not friends, but certainly coworkers. These giants, John Turturro, Woody Allen, Terry Winter, Martin Scorsese. Is there, these are highly creative and driven people, and of course very successful. Do you see a common denominator with these people that makes them, you think, who they are in any way? We can learn a lesson from you and looking on the inside of how these people work and develop?
John Turturro is a very close friend of mine, dear friend of mine, and I've worked with him in many plays.
Right.
And a couple of different, he was in Bronx Is Burning with me, my classic Dick Howser performance.
We've
done movies and lots of plays together, and I've been directed by him on Broadway and all over in Italy, all over the world. And this guy works, like, so hard. He's probably my most insight into, like, somebody at that level of greatness, I think. He works, like, an amazing amount. Like, the hours he puts in, the amount that he reads to prepare for something. I think, like, the old saying about genius being, you know, in man hours or something. I mean, it's like 1,000 hours or something. I have no idea. Well, I just see how hard that guy works.
And Max, it seems that, so what do you take away from that? Because you seem to be a very hardworking actor, from what we can gather.
Yeah, right. Well, also, you know, I mean, I am a hardworking actor. I mean, I work in my own way. He's taught me quite a bit about, you know, how much he reads about a subject before he starts it. This man reads, like John Turturro, he reads a lot. So I also was always a reader as well, but all the times I've worked with him, I've really learned how much more you you have to read. It's not just what you read, but it's what you extract from the material that you're reading. And that's a bit more of a mystery to me. But I work hard, but I don't work as hard as a John Turturro, for example. I just don't. I don't have that much of a stamina for it.
And how
I'm not talking about amount of projects. I'm talking about just, you know, directing and producing, and it's like nonstop.
I see.
Nonstop. Right. Tireless.
You've basically, over your career, have played a lot of Italian-American characters. And it seems like with Vinyl, now you're playing a Jewish character, and I know your background is sort of half and half. Is there anything special that you did for this particular character in Vinyl?
All I did was I read all the best books I get my hands on about the music business, of which I knew nothing.
Hmm.
I read and read and read, you know, as I was saying. I read this book, Hitmen, which was the first book I read, which was a great introduction to the music business. I read about all the great characters, but I didn't know, like, who's Julie going to be? Like, who is he? Because all I had was the pilot script. I was in, like, two scenes. I had no idea, like, from those two scenes, who this character was. And I shot the pilot with Scorsese, and then I sort of fell in love with the character because he kind of, like, through rehearsal, you know, he was just basically what I was already bringing to it, my own essence. He was just bringing it out more and more. And then I kind of fell in love with the guy. And I'm still not 100% sure who he is because we haven't really met all of Julie yet. I don't know, you know.
Yeah,
I think he's in flux, you know. It's going to grow. It's going to grow.
Definitely, because there was a scene in the second episode where Richie Finesta, who's the record company owner, decides to forego selling the company. He's going to dive back into the music scene. He's fired up in a meeting with your A&R guys. You're there, and as you were saying previously, the A&R team there is a little bit lost as to where the music is going at this point. And your character, you know, sort of like the a yes man, and see, and sort of kind of seeing that, you know what, he's
very
gonna,
much a yes man.
Yeah,
very gonna, much a like, hey, what do you want me to? What do you want? What does Richie want to hear? Like, you know, answer and then the yes and no at the same time, just to keep all my bases covered.
Right, and he's right there as the second-hand man, right-hand man. But what motivates a guy to do that and so forth? I guess we'll explore that down the line, I guess, huh?
Yeah, right. Well, the thing is with Julie is that he loves Richie. He would follow Richie over a cliff, probably. And he also desperately needs Richie because no one else is going to hire me at this point. I think really, like, I'm desperate to find the next big thing because if I get thrown out on the street, nobody's going to pick me up anywhere at this point, you know, and Richie is my lifeline.
Well, even though he's an A&R guy and it's in our world, understanding that he's got some power of being able to sign artists to record labels, that was the job back in the day. You're
That's
only
right.
as good as the last act that you,
right.
that
and
you signed.
And for Julie, it's maybe 5 years, and his last big signing was Jose Feliciano.
Right, exactly.
You know, who was, you know, was great and all, but not exactly, you know,
cutting edge.
Cutting
exactly
edge
in
1973.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. And, like 73, not, you know, it's been a while.
Right. Now, this series is set in 73, and I think it's moving slowly through the decade as it progresses, right? I mean, I think the first season is going to stay in, I think Terry said, the first 6 months of 1973, but it's going to progress, hopefully, as...
Yeah, I think next season will be 1974, I believe.
All right, so we'll definitely see the characters grow as music
definitely.
Grows and changes, for sure. And, of course,
Absolutely.
There's the interplay with all the characters as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, who's friends, who's not friends, who's you know, wants to take someone else's job. We've got that young girl that wants to be in the AR team, right? And so it's so multi-leveled. I think that's what's so great about it, the way this show presents a story that's not just going to be your typical drama. It's you're going to roll up your sleeves when you see this show, and you've got to kind of concentrate. You may want to watch a few times these episodes because there's stuff going on that you may miss the first time around.
Right, it's like any other television series. I mean, it has to find its audience. People have to watch a few episodes and then get to know the characters and then live with them. And then that's what happens.
And you got to like a couple of characters. And I would say that your character is, to me, the most relatable or most likable, if you want to say that, character in this.
Right.
That's just for me. I mean, everyone's going to grab onto different people, I think. You've got
that's
so
right.
many different
Everyone
people.
Will grab onto somebody, their favorite character or whatnot. And I think, you know, you just got to, I think it'll catch on. It's such a good show. It's so beautifully written and acted that...
And the production value puts you right there. So Sunday night's Vinyl, 9 o'clock on HBO. Max Cassella, we thank you so, so much for spending the hour with us.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Continued success with Vinyl and your career.
And
thank you, guys. A real pleasure.
Absolutely.
Thanks for having me.
We'll be coming on back right after this for one more minute for Everything Old Is New Again.
This business.
Now we've got one more minute there just to cap it off. And again, thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
My pleasure.
We wish you all the best. This is a project, and the other ones that we mentioned, I'm looking forward to seeing those other two as they come out. It's an exciting time for you, I guess, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, very exciting to be on a show like this. I haven't been a regular on any TV series since Doogie Howser went off the air, like whatever it was, 26 years ago or something.
Wow, right.
And this is a big deal for me.
Yeah, and you've got the ability to be that breakout character. I really think you've got something that comes off that screen. That's just me talking. But
I'm telling you guys, I've been reading on the internet the chatter amongst the audience, people who have seen the show, and Julie Silver jumps right out there.
There you go.
As an early fan favorite.
That's awesome.
And people really connect with the character.
So I'm on board with that. So thanks again on Everything Old Is New Again. We'll be back next week to continue our examination of America's pop culture. Come on back to Everything Old Is New Again.